It's TV school time. WOI-TV, in association with Iowa State Teachers College, presents another program in the Iowa TV Schooltime series, Landmarks in Iowa History. Today's topic is Story City. Your teacher is Herb Hake of Iowa State Teachers College.
Hello, boys and girls. No school today. No school here, I mean. There hasn't been any school here since 1885. This is the oldest pioneer school in Iowa. That is the oldest original building which was a school. This is the Sheldall School, which was built in 1859. 1 year before Abraham Lincoln was elected President of the United States. And this is the original building. Now, I know that last year I told you about the Galland School near Montrose, Iowa, over on the Mississippi, and I told you that was the first school in Iowa. Well, the building that I showed you at that time is a replica. That is, that building was rebuilt in 1924. The first school itself was built much nearer the Mississippi than the replica that you see today. And when the Keokuk Dam was built, the water backed up and covered that area where the first school was located. So even if you looked for the foundation of the first school in Iowa today, you would have to get a deep sea diving outfit and go down under the Mississippi River and look for it. But the building that stands at Galland today is just a replica. This, however, is the actual building. This building was put up by Norwegian settlers in 1859. And it's called the Sheldall School because it was built on land owned at that time by a Norwegian-American named Lars Sheldall. Now, the school itself, the building itself actually served as a school for only 26 years. It was built in 1859, and then a new building was built in 1885, and so there were no more classes here. And then for a time, this building was used as a kind of a practice room for the Riverside Cornet Band, one of the early musical organizations in central Iowa. And then after a time, the building was moved to a position some distance away where it would be more convenient for the members of the band. And after the band broke up, the building was moved to Randall, and it was used as a dwelling for several years. But in 1915, the members of the Riverside Cornet Band bought the building back again and moved it to the place where it had been originally built. So even though this building has been around, been moved several miles and has been moved three separate times, here it is today, back on its original foundations, exactly at the place where it was built in 1859. So if you want to see the oldest pioneer school in Iowa, you go to Story City and take a country road about 3 miles northeast of town, and you will come to this country school standing out here in the middle of the fields, not far from the farm owned by the Chernoggle brothers. And if people along the way don't know where the Sheldall School is, you ask them where the Chernoggle brothers live. And if they tell you how to reach the Chernoggle farm, then you can also find this building because you go right past it. Let me show you where Story City is. You can't miss it if you travel one of the two main highways in Iowa. Here is Story City. Now, I made that white dot so big that it covered this highway. Story City is really a mile east of this highway. Now, that's what happens when you make a dot too big. I wanted it to show so you could see it very clearly on television, and I made it a little too big. This north and south highway here is U.S. Highway 69. If you go up into Minnesota, you'll get to Minneapolis on Highway 69. And if you go south, you will get to Kansas City, Missouri, Dallas, Texas, and Point South. This is a very important north and south highway. And it runs through Ames. Here's Ames right here at the intersection of highways 69 and 30. This is U.S. Highway 30. It runs south of Marshalltown here, you see, and right smack dab through Ames and Story City is 12 miles north of Highway 30. If you go far enough east on Highway 30, you'll get to Atlantic City on the Atlantic Ocean. And if you go far enough west on Highway 30, you'll get all the way to Astoria, Washington, which is on the Pacific coast. So this highway here, Highway 30, runs from coast to coast. Here's Des Moines down here. And here is Fort Dodge. But you see, Ames and Story City are almost exactly in the center of the state. And if you're looking for Story City, you're coming from the east, take Highway 30 and then go north on Highway 69, go east 1 mile to Story City, and then you'll have very little trouble in finding the Sheldall School. But I have a film which shows exactly how to get to the Sheldall School from Highway 69. I sent that film to Ames, and I'm sure Mr. Weiss, our director, has it there. So if you are ready, Mr. Weiss, let's look at it. Here we go. Here is the sign that shows you how to go to Story City. When you're driving north on Highway 69, you'll see that big arrow which says Story City. And you go in the direction it's pointing, and then you get to Main Street. This is Broad Street. And it's very well named because this main street in Story City is a wide thoroughfare. This is Broad Street. And that car there is going in the direction we want to go. There is Emmanuel Lutheran Church on Broad Street. And then you go down toward the east about two blocks and turn north on Grand Avenue and you pass St. Patrick's Lutheran Church. This is St. Patrick's Lutheran Church. Go north on Grand Avenue till you get to that dead end, and then turn east on this gravel road, as that car is doing. And you keep driving toward the east for about a mile and a half, and then turn south, and you come past the Sheldall School. This is it. Also on a gravel road. And you see there are just cornfields around it. There's my station wagon. I had to stop in order to take these pictures, you see. And over there toward the left is the Chernago Farm. Now we're going north. We're looking north at the Sheldall School. There's the gravel road that we took. Still looking north across the fields. This is wonderful country here, wonderful farming country. Way over there is the elevator at Randall. And looking south, there is the elevator at Story City. And here is the new school in Story City. It's quite a change from that one-room rural school where the education in Scott Township began. This is a large, modern school and has all of the advantages of modern education. This, of course, is in Story City itself. However, this is not the Sheldall School. Always remember that. This is the modern public school and high school in Story City. I want to show you a picture in the Iowan magazine for February-March 1959. If you have been saving the Iowan magazine, it's this one here that has the flowers on the cover. The Iowan for February-March 1959. And there are some pictures in here of the Sheldall School taken by Rodney Fox, and a beautiful picture here, which shows the Sheldall School as it must have looked in the early days. Doesn't that look bleak and desolate and lonely out there? Well, the rural schools were built in regions like that, and you can get an idea of how it looked when it was first built in 1859 by going out there and seeing it. This picture gives you a nice feeling for this loneliness out there. Now, of course, the Norwegians who settled in Story City, in Scott Township, were farmers. They came from Norway, and they were looking for good farming land. And Scott Township has been called the 6 square miles which offer the best farming land in the entire United States. How do you like that? So these Norwegians who came to America knew what they were doing when they settled here. And of course they were concerned about educating their children, and so the school was built very shortly after they arrived. Built out of oak. You can still see the oak beams and the oak joists and the oak studding, which have made it possible for this school to stand through all these years. And of course it has to be kept in shape. It should be preserved, but the underpinnings, the oak sills, the joists, the studding, are just as strong as they were when the building was put up. And when these early Norwegian farmers cut the timbers on the banks of the Skunk River and put them up. And of course they were very thrifty. School books in those days had to be used by several generations. And the main concern of the Norwegians who settled in this area was for learning reading, writing, and arithmetic. The three R's, reading, writing, arithmetic. Here is the kind of book they used for reading. See, it's a McGuffey's reader. And inside, it had some steel engravings which made the stories interesting for the boys and girls who had to read them. Then there was writing, the second of the three R's. And the most popular book for teaching writing was the Blueback Speller. Inside you see not only the alphabet, but over here on this side, the way letters should be written. So writing was very important. Not only to spell words correctly, but to write them in such a way that they would be beautiful to the eye. The boys and girls had to practice these writing exercises first of all on a slate. But then they had to learn also how to use a pen. And this was the kind of pen they used in the early days. This is a goose quill made out of a goose feather. You see the end is sharpened here. And then it was protected by a little wooden sleeve like that. And then they had an ink pot. This one happens to be made out of horn. And there was a cork in the top here that held the ink. And you dipped the goose quill in there like that, and then did the writing. And then, they didn't have blotters in those days, so they unscrewed the top of the inkwell, and inside, in the bottom, there was a sand shaker. Put sand in here, and they shake this on the paper that they had written, and the sand would soak up the ink, and they'd blow the sand off the paper, and it would be dry. But this is a goose quill. They didn't have ballpoint pens in those days. But they were able to do beautiful writing. Here is a sample of some writing that was done by one of the early pupils. Isn't that beautiful? Notice that slant on there. I wish I could write like that. Maybe I should have gone to the Sheldall School. Well, the other R, just briefly, was arithmetic. Here is an old arithmetic book. The cover just about to come off. And inside were the addition tables, the subtraction tables, multiplication, and division tables, and many, many problems. reading, writing, and arithmetic. The school term lasted 6 months, and then after that there was a term of parochial school in which the boys and girls were taught about the Bible. So this building served not only as a public school, but also as a parochial school where the Bible should be taught. And of course the Norwegians were very religious, and they went to church. And this building served as a church also. This was the only public building in this whole neighborhood. During the week it served as a school. At night they had singing classes and community parties. And on Sunday it was used for church. And the Norwegians would put on their Sunday clothes, and the Norwegian farmers wore a long coat to church. And back here in the coat tails there was always a narrow pocket, just the right size for a songbook. This is a Norwegian hymnal. Notice how narrow it is? That's because it would fit this narrow pocket in the coat tail of the Norwegian farmer. Now, when these boys and girls went to school, they of course had to take their lunch. And the Norwegian Americans liked fish and many other kinds of food which their parents had learned about in the old country. Fish was very, very popular, and even in Story City today, fish is a staple item on the market. I got this at the market in Story City. Here's ocean perch from Norway. And here are some more kinds of fish from Norway. Crown Norway sardines, King Oscar, Kipper snacks. And here's some more Norwegian meat, King Oscar meatballs. And the Norwegians are very fond of goat cheese. This is also imported from Norway, goat cheese. And they're very fond of things like this. This is a kringla. Kringla, or called angel wings sometimes. These are very good when dunked in coffee. The Norwegians drink more coffee than any other people anywhere on earth. And this is dunked in coffee. This was made for me by Mrs. Melberg, who is a Norwegian. And here is some Christmas bread. This is julekake. This was baked for me so I could show it to you on the program today by my secretary in Cedar Falls, Carol Powis, who is a very good Scandinavian. This is julekake. Let me slice off a piece here and show you what it looks like on the inside. Just happen to have a knife with me. Look at the raisins in there. Raisins and ground up bits of orange. This is mighty toothy. Very, very good. Now, the Norwegians were thrifty people. They believed in saving their money. There wasn't a great deal of money at the time they first came here. And the farmers all got together and built this Sheldall school back here. And they were self-supporting almost entirely. And they threw nothing away. They were very, very thrifty. And so, in the course of their lives, they developed many, many things which were well-made, even though they didn't cost a great deal of money. And these have been handed down for generations. I've been very fortunate to have on my program today a number of things which were loaned to me by Professor O.A. Olson, who lives in Ames and who was for over 35 years the head of the engineering drawing department at Iowa State. He is an inventor, and even though he's retired now, he is still busy every day making these things that he has invented, among them the Ames lettering instrument, of which he has made over 1 million, and many other things like that. He's a very, very resourceful and ingenious man. But Professor Olson was born in Norway, and he has many, many things that were brought to this country from Norway by his parents when he was just a little boy, and he has saved these things. Here, for example, is a ruler made out of wood, very, very old. I'm sure you've heard of Irish home rule, haven't you? Well, this is Norwegian home rule. This might, in a sense, be called a board of education. And sometimes the parents and the teachers would apply this to the seat of learning. And in this way, boys and girls got their education from the bottom up. See? Here's another thing which the Norwegians made. This is a tina, a wooden box. See, it's oval in shape. And that oval shape gives it a kind of a natural spring. And this is a latch here. And you open the lid and swing it over like that, and the boys and girls would carry their lunch to school in a box of this kind. This is a tina. They'd fill this with sandwiches. And they would carry the kringla or their fish sandwiches or their lefse. I didn't show you the lefse, did I? Lefse is a flat bread of the Norwegians. Almost wafer thin. This is lefse. And this was used to make sandwiches. Mashed potato sandwiches or lutefisk. Lutefisk is fish which has been treated in lye. And the lutefisk would be put between two pieces of lefse and then put in the lunchbox, one of these tinas, and taken to school. Well, that's a tina. Here is something else that was made by the father of Professor Olson. This is a lady's vanity case. See the mirror in the top? Hair could be put in there overnight. Here's a little drawer down here, putting hairpins and things of that sort, combs. And here is a case for men. This is a tonsorial case. If I can get it open. They're very clever about their locks. Another mirror, see? And this was used by the man of the house when he did his shaving. His shaving brush. Here's a razor, straight edge razor. These are very, very old. Not a nail used in making these boxes. All mortise and tenon joints. And here's another example of the thrift of these Norwegian settlers. Notice there's a watch in there. The farmer would carry this watch in his pocket during the day, and then when he came home at night, he would hang it in this little case, and that made a clock out of it. So he didn't have to buy an extra clock. The watch served as a clock. They didn't throw their cow's horns away either. They flattened them like this and made powder horns out of them. And then there's a homemade spring at the end so they could pour the powder out. And fastened to this is a little cup also made out of horn. They'd pour the required amount of powder in here, put it in the gun, then the required amount of shot in here. And then there was a little box also fastened to it. And in here they would carry the caps so that the powder would explode. This is made out of wood, not a nail in it. And after all these years, it still works beautifully. Here's another little sand shaker made out of wood, used when you're writing. Sand would be put in there. And there's a spring effect here, just achieved by the wood, the way the wood is put together. Here is a brace and bit, kind used by the early Norwegian farmers and settlers around Story City. See, the brace itself is made out of wood, and you can change the bit and look like a clothespin, you see. But that has a spring effect. And then you can put another one in there if you want another size. You have to make the circles match. There's a dot at the top of this and a dot at the top of that. And it just fits right in, see? And you're all ready to go. Very, very clever. Well, this shows something of the ingenuity and the thrift and the ability of the Norwegian settlers to save money, to make everything serve a double purpose. If there was a little scrap of wood left or a little scrap of horn, this was used. It wasn't thrown away. And they did the same way about their schools. The school was made to serve many, many purposes. It was a community center, a place where the boys and girls went to school, a place where they had their meetings at night, a place where they had church on Sunday. Thrift, one of the important things about life in the Norwegian community. I forgot to show you these pictures, didn't I? Here's a distant view of the school. See, the windows are all boarded up. Inside the school building are these pictures of all the teachers who ever served the school. And here's a picture of one of the Chernogle brothers, Mr. Herman Chernogle. Here's an old reed organ used by the singing societies. And here's a picture of Mr. Chernogle's uncle, Nehemiah Chernogle, who went to the Sheldall School as a boy. He was also a member of the Riverside Cornet Band. Well, I've talked about quite a few of the Norwegian customs and about the uses that were made of the school. Nowadays, we think of school teachers as people who look like this. The majority of teachers in our schools nowadays are women. And they fix their hair something like this. I always like to draw hair, something of which I have so little myself. And here is a teacher of today. Here are the eyeglasses. I don't mean to say that all teachers wear glasses, but some of them do. Here is a teacher of today. Your teacher look like that? No. Well, in the days of the Sheldall School, the teachers looked more like this. See? This was the appearance of the teachers in those days. They had a heavy mustache, lots of hair around their chin, and they were men. They didn't have women teachers at the Sheldall School. Not one. Not during all the time that the Sheldall School was in service. Well, I hope you'll visit the Sheldall School yourself someday. Next week, we are going to Boone, and we'll learn what the effect of the railroad was upon this early community in Iowa history. Until next week, goodbye.
Today your teacher has been Herb Hake of Iowa State Teachers College. Landmarks in Iowa History is produced for Iowa TV Schooltime by WOI-TV in association with Iowa State Teachers College. TV Schooltime is presented daily, Monday through Friday, at 10:30 a.m. by the Iowa Joint Committee for Educational Television.